Universe movies to date, including Batman Year One, Teen Titans The Judas Contract, and Batman The Killing Joke, Sam Liu. Screenwriter behind several of the Lego DC superhero films and Justice League The Flashpoint Paradox, Jim Green. He's the voice of Rigby in the regular show and Penguin in the Caped Crusaders animated films, and tonight, our Hugo Strange, William Sayers. Young Justice as Ben in several iterations of the Ben 10 saga, and Superman in the beloved Legion of Superheroes, but in Gotham by Gaslight, he served it up as our nefarious Harvey Dent, Yuri Lowenthal. She has played Wonder Woman in the DC Superhero Girl series, Daphne for the past 2 decades in the Scooby-Doo franchise, and tonight she's pulling double duty as both Sister Leslie and Jason of the Three Robins, Greg Griffin. A veteran of 3 Saw films, the voice of King Faraday in Justice League Unlimited, and best known as Luke in the Gilmore Girls, but tonight you heard him as Commissioner Gordon and Scott Patterson. He's one of the stars of Dexter and Limitless and is soon to appear opposite Mel Gibson and Vince Vaughn in Dragged Across Concrete. She's our fierce Selena Kyle in Gotham by Gaslight, Jennifer Carpenter. An American Crime Story, and following up on his triumphant turns as the Dark Knight in both Batman Under the Red Hood and Young Justice, our title character in Batman Gotham by Gaslight, Bruce Greenwood.
This will become clear later. A quick note, executive producer Bruce Timm sends his regards, but he's taking tonight off to celebrate his birthday, so he is missed, but it's an acceptable excuse. And we'd like to acknowledge Frederick Weidman, the composer of Batman Gotham. You're very far away from me, but I'll... Hello down there. This film is obviously based on the graphic novel by Brian Augustin and Mike Mignola. So what was your adaptation process? Because how many of you guys are familiar with the graphic novel? How many of you read it? Quite a few, all right. So it's a little bit different. So how did you guys decide which parts to keep and which parts to kind of tweak for this adaptation?
I'll leave this to Jim, because actually, it's Bruce, and because he's the executive producer, and Jim, they wrote the story, actually.
And Alan Burnett, who's just recently retired as a big, yes. Well, those of you who've read it know that it's a fantastic piece, and it's also very short, and so we felt we had to extend it. It's also a murder mystery, and so if so many of the fans have read it, and if it's the same murderer, then it's not much of a surprise. It's not a whodunit, but when is the movie over? So we had to mix it up a little bit. And then, of course, we wanted to add Selena because it needed to be a two-hander, and we needed to have an empowered woman in a movie where women are being killed. We wanted to pepper the whole thing with lots of characters from the Batman cast. And so that's what we did.
It's very nicely done. Sam, was there ever kind of a consideration of adapting Mike Mignola's style visually for the animation?
We talked about it a little bit, but you know, again, our budgets aren't the biggest, the most we can with what we have, and so, and if you know, you guys are all familiar with Bruce Timm's style. His whole philosophy on design is simplifying, you know, because and hopefully, you know, with that in mind, you know, we'll get a better product. So McDonald's style, I think, is so. I mean, it's not like Kirby, but it's similar to Kirby because it's so sort of like black shadow specific, and so those things are very difficult to imitate. And also, I think Mimbala's style is almost as much sort of how it's composed to that contributes to it. There's a certain point I feel like when you draw it or compose it a different way, it doesn't feel like Mike anymore. So we sort of did something that we thought was obviously not like his style, but sort of, you know, felt, you know, like it was, you know, of that.
It evokes it.
Yeah, it evokes it more than actually imitates it, you know. But we did think about it for, you know, a little bit, but I think very quickly we figured that it's probably a mistake because I think if you don't do it right, it's going to look bad.
That makes total sense. For Yuri Gray and William, you've obviously all voiced characters in the DC Animated Universe before, so I'm curious about the kind of challenges of bringing these particular characters into an Elseworlds tale, which is obviously already a very different setting from what fans are used to, and how that kind of differed, if it did at all, your approach compared to what you've done previously. Maybe going down the line.
Okay. Well, I was amazed at how well the world of Batman merges with the world of steampunk. I mean, I think it's a very gritty, visceral world to begin with. And, you know, so many of the heroes these days that you see represented in media are on a computer hacking into a database somewhere. Batman bleeds, he sweats, you know, he swings across the city under his own power. There's a grit and a earthiness to it, and I think that the style of steampunk really suits that. And so to me, it felt like a natural. And I was a big fan of the graphic novel. I'm a big fan of what these guys did with the adaptation.
Bill plays the worst psychiatrist. If you have some issues, don't. He's got one solution.
Oh, sure. Yeah, with 2020 hindsight. Yeah. I was state of the art once.
Just stick him in a hole, it'll be fine.
Yeah.
Solves everything.
I was just so happy to play Harvey Dent that I didn't think so much how would I play Harvey Dent, you know, in Victorian times. I left that up to, you know, getting into the room and having Bruce Timm there and Wes Gleason there, who did the voice direction, and as he might be in this piece of the audience.
Thank you.
I went in trusting that whatever I brought, they would erase and start from new. They would work with what they wanted, what they were looking for, and then I just got to play with them. So
he's reprehensible. I think Yuri's best line is when he hears that women are allowed in Bruce's room. He goes, "At least we still have something."
And I'm a nice guy in real life, and I always jump at the chance to play bad guys. Villains, it's using my acting to act out in a socially acceptable way, so.
I loved playing Sister Leslie, but I played Catwoman so often that I was kind of like, oh, it must be letting Laura do it. I didn't know, and I met the lovely ladies playing Catwoman in the thing, so I thought I wasn't playing Catwoman, and they're like, oh, no, you're going to sing as her, and I was like, oh, fine. They threw me a little
job.
Yeah, I met her, she's like, oh, I was like, I'm singing as you, and she's like, thank God. And the Sister Leslie character, I mean, I've been a lifelong Catholic, so I was looking forward to playing a nice Irish. Hope I made them proud. She's the toughest one in the whole movie, I think.
She kind of is.
But oh, and then I always like to play little boys because
I wouldn't have even thought.
It's better than
seeing the cast list. I was like, oh my god, wonderful job of playing.
There was one real boy, and I go, like, damn, that's just something you just can't. Hardly any lady can get really, really close to that.
and I tried, but it was impressive. I don't know what you guys thought, but I did a wonderful moment. Scott, for you, what was it kind of like to walk that delicate line between kind of keeping the villainous side of Jim kind of under wraps? Did you kind of try and slip any winks to the audience, or were you trying to play it as straight and heroic as possible so that when the cowboy came, it was extra surprising?
No, it's just right there on the page, and you just kind of do what's on the page.
Yeah.
You know, that's the job that day. But I do want to say, you know, getting a phone call saying Warner Brothers wants you to play Commissioner Gordon in the Batman series, and I thought to myself, am I that old? And I know it's just a voiceover, right? So it's kind of a moronic statement. But I remember as a little kid watching, you know, I grew up on the original series. You know, the original, and it was on at 8 o'clock, and we begged our parents to stay up that late to watch it, and they said no, and we would hide under the kitchen table and listen to the den, the whole thing. And Commissioner Gordon was the stuffiest. You know, he was like, he was like the last guy you want to play, right? And it's like, why would? And so when they said it, I said, I turned to my wife and I said, they think I can pull that off, but he was far more dynamic and interesting, and dropped into that Victorian England, and it was just, you know, it's such a, you know, historical fiction is so brilliant, and it's so fun, and it really opened it up for me as an actor, because I got to, you know, sensorially do all those, you know, take that journey with that character at that time. And then the flip side of it was, you know, what every actor wants to play. You know, they want to play the dual role. They want to play the bad guy, but they also want to do that dual role thing. So watching it, I thought, A, I'm finally in a film with Bruce Greenwood, which is kind of cool. And B, it's a really good role, or it's a really good duality to play. So just a tremendous amount of fun. And one thing that I mentioned in DC that I forgot to mention in DC that I want to mention here, and I haven't met you, but the music was spectacular.
Yeah.
It was. Yeah. I don't mean to roll on, but I think music is one of the most important elements of any film. I mean, it's so easy to ruin a film with the wrong tone and the wrong music, but man, that was just super. And it's one of the things that really engages me about a film is how well the composer, you know, how spare they are with everything, and when they cut. I mean, it's fascinating to me. It's the one thing that I would love to do, or I would love to try to score a film. I probably wouldn't be very good, because I know it's a real art. But kudos to you.
Thank you. Yep.
Please stand up in a bit.
Herbert von Karajan, there he is.
Jennifer, you're obviously no stranger to playing very dynamic, self-sufficient characters. So what kind of most spoke to you about playing Selena, and what was your preparation process like at the beginning?
I think people have said this before, but it's fun to play something you're afraid of. And even tonight, this reminds me of, like, I took German in high school for some reason. And I got to the point where I could order a beer and I could maybe give someone directions. I don't know why I would be giving directions, though. I don't know where I was. But I feel that sort of handicap here, because I don't have an encyclopedic knowledge of comic books and DC versus Marvel and whatnot, obviously. But I am intrigued by it. And the passion that's behind it is something I covet. I tried to be a Catholic, but I couldn't find my faith the way that I needed to.
Well, you don't need much.
But I know that I'm at the beginning of something, because the more I look at it, the more I feel that magnet, you know, pulling me in. So when I got the call that, you know, the invitation had been extended to be a part of, you know, to be in the legacy of Catwoman was incredible. And I thought, so this is before she becomes the cat burglar, before everything I've ever met. So I get to help turn that key to start that engine, that motor, that purr. And again, with Wes's direction, I thought, well, there's nothing I can't do. Yes, I'm handicapped, but I have someone who's like fluid. So it was really exciting. And I got to see it for the first time today. It was, I don't know how I got here. I don't know how anybody got my number to get here.
It's really exciting. Good.
It is a talent in and of itself to be able to communicate solely with your voice before you have any of this or any of that sound in front of you. So it's I feel very lucky to be in your company.
Of course, you're obviously a dap hand at playing Batman at this point. So how did you kind of approach this? Did you change your approach in any way because of the period?
Well, there was a lot of Bruce Wayne in this, yeah. So you got to see a softer character and a guy who was uncomfortable in the presence of really powerful women.
We're everywhere.
So that was fun to experiment with. And I mean, speaking to my history with Batman, like, we were not allowed to watch the original Batman, the POW Biff Batman, because it was too violent.
They kept telling me it was too late.
No, it was too, for my parents, it was too violent. So then when we did Under the Red Hood, you know, as you said, you don't have the privilege of seeing, you know, you see a few images, but you have no idea how terrifyingly brutal it's going to be. Remember when I went to the screening of that, I was just like, I was floored at how violent it was.
Yeah.
So I sort of went into this thinking, you don't know how it's going to evolve on the screen. So, and a lot of times you just kind of, you made a decision about how you feel about this scene, but in terms of how it's going to fit into the whole visual feel of the movie, you really haven't got a clue. So it's exciting and scary, and then you watch the thing and you go, oh God, okay.
I know, it's so jarring to me to even hear these characters say, like, shit or everything. My goodness, I'm just not used to it. But you guys are pretty restrained. You know, there's violence, but it's very implied. You kind of aren't gratuitous with it, which I think is a real testament to how much you can kind of convey just by kind of the implicit, just the bloody knife is, you know, horrifying enough.
It's pretty bloody.
It's bloody, but you could see more, I would say. So
we got an R.
You did get an R. I deserve.
You want to see
R.
more?
No, that's true. It's not.
There's a European cut. It's, you know, CSI.
But how did you guys kind of tread that line, I suppose, of what to show, what not to show, in terms of kind of keeping the tone of it? Because obviously when you have the R, you can kind of get away with doing a lot more, but I like the restraint of it that you do kind of imply as much, and it is just as powerful without needing to, you know, show someone getting their throat slit.
Well, it's interesting because, you know, even though, like, you know, cartoon and movies or TV are, you know, similar, but still there's certain things that inherently kind of don't work in a way, or it's probably going to take some time before it becomes sort of like believable, you know. And so so when it was, we're sometimes trying to push things like, oh, that would be perfectly fine in a movie, but it doesn't really work in animation, you know. But I think the basic thing is just like, just because we have an R, we don't want to go gratuitous over it. You know, a lot of it is sort of, you know, we don't want to do something just for the sake of doing it. We want to make sure it's sort of right tonally for the type of story that we're telling.
Except for the profanity, that we just did. Joe picked up on that joke. So in the original Batman series, Robin always says, you know, holy olio, you know, holy, you know, this, and it's always holy something. And so the first time you see him, he says, holy shit. It's like, you're in a different movie.
I love it. Well, I want to leave time for all of your questions, and that is what this is for. Whoever asks the best question, which I will decide because I have ultimate power here, will get this lovely poster signed by all of these beautiful people up here. So there are two microphones, so if you can put your hand up and wait for the microphone to get to you before you start speaking so that all these people can hear you, that is very helpful. Anyone got questions? Hands up. Yes. Let's go, the gentleman in the back. What did I just say? It's true, you're very good at enunciating. You probably
can shout questions.
Yes, continue.
Being that the film obviously took in Victorian London, or Victorian Gotham, did either of you take time to do any dialect training as far as taking your character and applying almost the Victorian aspect to your accent? I imagine some of the wording was very Victorian in the language, so I was just curious, what did you do on your own time to research speaking the way they would in Gotham and Victorian area?
I just trusted, when we got in there, I trusted that Wes would keep us in line.
Yeah, the famous people who got calls, I didn't get a call. I just showed up to the studio and they're like, great, this is what you're playing. And I was like, they got calls offering them the part, and then they had an option to say no or not.
You're a contract player.
Get in there, do it.
I mean, it's in the script to a certain extent, and then Wes and Bruce sort of kept us on, you know, not to have us not sound too modern at times.
Yeah, I don't know how I would if, you know, Batman.
Please re-record it with your dialogue.
But one of the things that we did talk about was that, you know, it is Victorian America, you know, and so the I feel like the trope that everybody goes to is, you know, English, you know, or England. And so we tried to sort of stay away from, you know, that specifically. You know, like Jennifer, I was, you know, I've been a huge fan of your stuff, and so one of the things that, you know, with her specifically we were talking about was like of her sounding too, what's the word you used, really? Like too sort of like modern, or like, you know, and again, her performance, like after the first couple of lines, just sort of the poise that she has in her voice, and the, you know, it seemed timeless versus being like too modern or too, and so. Instead of necessarily picking at accents, you know, we're trying to find sort of almost like, you know, timelines versus a time period, you know, or timelessness.
It's tricky because when you write it, when you think of this era, you've seen so many movies, they all take place in London, and that's the accent you come out with.
Right.
But when you think of America in the same time, it's the Old West, and it's, you know, the OK Corral. So it's... But it's Gotham is kind of New York City, so there are a ton of immigrants in there. So you know, and which Commissioner Gordon evidently takes offense with. So Sister Leslie is from Ireland, and so Chief Bullock, Bulldog, you know, he's supposed to be the Chief O'Hara. It was the original, and Chief O'Hara's the kind of drunken Irish cop who's always talking to Square Commissioner Gordon in the live action series, except that, of course, he's cruel and horrific.
Anyone else? We got two down here. We can get to both of you.
All right. Hello, my name's Ryan, and I have a question regarding the mask, the cowl. So what was the deciding factor, as in the blackout of the eye, how this one it does not have it, and why was that decision made?
Oh, for Batman.
Mm-hmm. So usually, you know, that it's always blackout, and now we can actually see the flesh. So why was that something that you decided to do?
It was something actually in the source material. I think Mignola's Batman, it was a lot more sort of like he was wearing goggles, or like he was. I think we had a discussion about it for a while about like whether it put goggles on him or it was just kind of sort of cut out. There was a discussion also about like tint. Do we put a tint over it? Because to me, like the flesh was kind of sticking out a little too much. But you know, Bruce Lee, being executive producer, he overruled me and he liked the skin element of it. You know, I think a lot of it was just because it is supposed to be, you know, a different reality, but also a different time. So he liked the fact that it looked very different than Batman sort of designs that we found.
And you see him, you care more about him. Batman, when you can't see his eyes, well, he's perfect. He's like James Bond. He does everything right. But this is almost not Batman. It's Bruce Wayne in a costume. And so you kind of, you're always looking. You just got shot. You just got punched in the gut. You feel more for him.
So this is for gadgets.
Oh, dueling mics.
You go first, further back. That's fine.
All right.
I'll allow it.
Half a poster.
All right, with this being the first animated Elseworld movies, I was just wondering, with this such being like one of those classic storylines, how do you make the decision to make those story changes that weren't in the original?
There are a couple of reasons. It's a very short book. It's a beautiful book. It's got a lot of atmosphere. The mystery is maybe just a tiny bit simple because of the shortness of the book. So as we lengthened it, we had to, you know, add all these other characters and also drop in other people from Batman's, you know, Bat family that, you know, people want to see. And also, because so many of you are familiar with the mystery, we felt we had to give another culprit. So we just tried to stick as close as we could to the feel and tone of the original without just kind of doing it again, you know?
So, given that Batman does most of his fighting with gadgets, how did you guys approach modern gadgets and, you know, kind of fitting those into the Victorian age? You saw his grapple gun, it was a bit, it was steam power.
Yeah.
You know, so how did you apply modern engineering to that, along with his bike and all that fun stuff?
Well, I mean, I feel like even with, let's just say, like contemporary Batman, right, he's maybe one, two steps probably into the future as far as like what is out contemporarily, right? And so I feel like, you know, it's really easy, like, you know, it's 18, whatever, 90, and what's one or two steps beyond 1890, which is not even 1970, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so, but still in a, you know, a fantasized kind of thing that's surely never had grapple guns even in the 70s, you know, but we try not to go too far. I mean, I remember again, like when we were discussing, you know, this Bruce and I was discussing design-wise with the movie, or even just sort of how we're gonna shoot it, or totally how we're gonna make it. There were some people on the crew that really was excited about the steampunk element, and they just wanted to go total, like, crazy steampunk. And Bruce was just like, no, I think it's, we're playing it pretty straight, but just Batman's the only person that has some steampunk element.
And the motorcycle is real. I found it was online, and they like that, and it, but if you look at it on YouTube, it's ridiculous, and it goes about 4 miles an hour. It literally makes a putt sound. There was another instance of that where I found it like a super early sedan, you know, automobile, and told Bruce, it's like, well, when Bruce Wayne makes his big entrance at the fair, he can be in this cool car. And then I showed him the picture, and it's like, because it's like a car that you go, it's not like, oh, what a badass.
I want to piggyback on that. I just love that massive leather utility belt. It's like,
I didn't know where that was going.
It's, sorry. No, not there. But yeah, it's like something that, like, it's like a butcher's apron or something. That thing is huge, and you can imagine holding all these heavy pieces of steam powered equipment.
That's like he's got a chair in there.
Yeah, right.
Before he gets to the game,
I just love that. That's all. Please carry.
Yes.
With so many voice talents here, and with so many red herrings in this movie, do you six prefer to play the hero or the villain?
The villain.
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 Hero.
The villain is winning right up until he's not, which is something I love about the playing those guys.
Yes, you right there?
Well, some of these Elseworlds, you know, one of the things that's fun to see is like different takes on classic characters. Was there any that you thought to include but didn't, like someone that the animates in art or anything like that?
Yeah, we dropped a lot in. I had a. There's a certain character who wears white makeup and laughs a lot. I can't name him, but I had a thought for where he could have gone in there. But if you all buy several copies, there could be a sequel. And we all work, and maybe.
All righty. Anyone else?
Yes, m'lady.
You kind of answered my question. At the end, I was thinking to myself, how is Bruce going to prove his innocence? Because, you know, he died. Well, not him, but, you know, the bad guy. And then I thought, well, maybe they're going to make a sequel.
I would love to make that sequel. And we will explain how Harvey Dent has a change of heart and exonerates Bruce and then has a terrible accident. And he doesn't have Hugo Strange, the excellent alienist, there to cure him and goes criminally insane.
I was looking for it this time. Did you hide any masks in Hugo Strange's office? That seemed like a place ripe to put some sort of Easter egg in there. And I looked and didn't find one.
Oh, I don't think there are. We had a whole panel of like masks, but we were going more of a sort of like, you know, is it some of it too tribal? Is it some too, you know, one or the other?
That was a great mask, by the way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's
right. Do I win the poster?
Yes.
Did you?
Nailed it.
I got excited about the sequels and then I realized my character was dead.
One of them. One of them.
Oh, yeah, Jason.
Robin is still alive.
Little psycho Jason.
Yeah, Jason. Okay,
I remember.
Really
he looked
good.
Like he wanted
my
to take
hopes
out.
On Jason for my children's
steampunk
college.
Red Hood. I'm here for it. Anyone else? Yes, sir?
Hi. My question is that what's the difference for like animating an animation film? Because like when you like do it live action, it's much more like present. But when it's animation, you know, you just do storyboarding that becomes into animation. How do you direct that? How do you go through the steps of directing an animation film? And how's it different from like?
I just about to answer that.
He does this.
We have a board artist. Oh, enter.
The artists in the film, right?
Yeah.
He was actually the supervising storyboard artist, so he
stand up.
Yeah.
You're wearing your Jack the Ripper shoes. Those are just. speaking as a non-animator and a writer, I can tell you that mostly it's magic. It starts out as drawings, and then you go and get another job, and when you come back 18 months later, there's a beautiful movie. So I think mostly elves have done it.
No, it really is. I mean, so much of it is this restraint, and this it's like having a big idea, but then having simplified in a way where it's not going to get messed up in animation. You know, like the timing and all these things that can mess up the purity of sort of what the intent is. So it really is this thing of like, how do you make it seem like this big event? But then how do you sort of make it so it's animatable? You know, so again, like we're not, you know, like we don't have the budgets of like a Disney movie or even a feature film and stuff like that. So a lot of it is like, how do you sort of get like a good pose and just, you know, have them hopefully hit the key visual expressions on it. We do a lot, especially with this, like with holds, to let the emotion sink in. I feel like most of the time, like when I'm editing, I'm trying to figure out places where to hold, you know, or where to separate things so things become clearer.